The first one is our resident screen. And been invited to reside at Hannah.
So in your packet, you'll get, you have a packet that's number 2A1. And in that is a basic application to join Nightingale Camp as a resident. Everything works out. There's the basic rules of the camp, and if they get that again, they sign these rules. They're just basic rules for a community. And then we have the resident manual and the guide and stuff like that. And mandatory meetings, we always have mandatory meetings once a week. Everybody in camp as residents does either, depends on how many, we've ran a camp before with 30 residents. So a lot of them to do gate duty, only have to do like two gate duties. And they're usually 4-hour little shifts where you watch the gate. Usually you accept donations. You track volunteers that come in and visitors and stuff like that. And during the day, they make sure that the gates get open for the bathrooms to get cleaned, and they make sure the trash is out on trash day. So, and then there's So they fill out this application. There's a lot of different things in this application. I'm very,
Like in terms of who would come to fill out the application, or anybody in the community that's without a home could come and
yes.
apply?
But okay. There's restrictions, like the city put rules on our camp, so we can't have children, we can't have families, and we can't have drug use and alcohol. So those are big things that make even the camp run a lot smoother, because no drugs and no alcohol makes anything run smoother. So those are really big stipulations. So if they turn in an application and they got alcohol on their breath, I don't let them in, you know?
Nathan, what about convicted felons?
Convicted felons, it depends on the level of conviction. The city has put restrictions on that, that I can't let in people with sex offenders and stuff like that, but that's about the only one that we don't let in. We try to give everybody a chance if they want the chance, if they really want to change their lives. Like a rest stop is all about people moving off the streets and into housing. Not just to have a place to hide out and do nothing. You know, it's a place to better your lives. So we do wraparound services. I use Laurel Hill, Willamette Family, and a few other services in town. And I usually have them come to camp on Mondays and Tuesdays. And they talk to the individual residents at camp and see how they might fit in with their programs to get housing.
Could you repeat those agencies again?
Oh, Laurel Hill and Willamette Family Recovery are my two biggest ones.
So Nathan, if I might follow up on Cindy's question. So you asked that question in the application whether someone is convicted of sex.
Yes, I do a background check.
And
there's a full page on the application. Very background, asks for the social security, the birth date, the first and last name, and what crimes they have committed. Except that elderly women all the time, actually. Be amazed. 75-year-old women are still homeless. And I need the police to be safe. Mm-hmm. Actually, we
why do you have the gate?
It's like a safety, so that we can just come in on any tent and take whatever they want from the outside. So we like a gated community, and the gate is like security for everybody, so it'll be safe. So when they leave during the day, because we have a rule that some of the elderly women that are very disabled stay during the day. But most people leave from 9 to 4 to go out and do things in the community and look for work or look for services to help them or go take baths and showers at the service station and stuff like that.
The goals that you have in general for residents who come into this camp in particular, in prior camps?
Housing. Get them off the streets and get them housed. And it said, it wanted me to give an example. And one of the most recent ones that we're friends saw on Facebook and stuff, and we went to Country Fair together, a young woman came and wanted to come to my camp because she was having coming off drugs at rehab. So she came through the Lamb family. And within 2 weeks of being in our camp, she found out she was pregnant. So, Tracy even took her to the hospital when she gave birth. And she's still housed up today. And her baby's just so beautiful. And with Nightingale, if I would have said, no, I can't take you, she would have had her baby probably out on the streets or something. So it really touches me. And there's video, more of them. We had an elderly woman that got evicted for smoking in her apartment, and I gave her a place to stay, and she would have been out on the streets in the cold last winter.
So where are they now?
They're housed up.
In?
In communities, in apartments.
So they transitioned out?
Yes.
That's our goal always, to transition. It's not a place where we want people to live for 3 years. It's a place where we want people to transition, and whether they transition to a Section 8 apartment, or they, to a regular house, or, you know, to an RV that they own and park somewhere. We just want them to be more on their feet.
And a mother and a son that got evicted, and he was mentally disabled. And through our camp, he got to be with the services, and he actually got to be in a stable place where he could meet with his caseworker. His caseworker actually came to camp and met with him and helped him go out and get his phone and fill out his papers and take him on to meetings and stuff so he could get his housing and stuff. And actually, his mom became his care provider, and now they're living in a house together in Springfield. And she's the care provider, and he's mentally disabled.
Well, my question's along those lines, in that what assistance do y'all offer for the people that come there once you see what their needs are? Do you or does the board try to hook them up with appropriate agencies, like you said, with a mentally disabled child, you know which services are available, and you actually call and help set up things for them? Because I realize there's lots of people that they're just totally lost in the systems, you know, and they're out on the street because they don't know how to navigate the system. So who gives that assistance, and to what extent do you get that assistance?
There's so much different services in this community that I use, and they usually come to camp on Mondays and Tuesdays and meet with the individuals and work it out. They do that little questionnaire that's like 80 questions or 70 questions, and then they get like evaluated and they see if they're like a 9 or a 18. If they're an 18, they get moved up higher on the list because they're more fragile. So yeah, I work with a lot of services.
Yeah, what's the main?
Somebody comes?
Yeah.
Who comes?
Shelter Care, Willamette Family, Laurel Hill. Most from our community.
There's front doors. And also, I want to just stress again that there's always the steering committee there behind Nathan and Tracy. For instance, last year, I don't know if the woman you were talking about was the same one I'm going to talk about today. She is an older woman, and it was very cold last year, winter. And it was too cold for a woman of that age, really, to even be in a tent with a sleeping bag. And she called 911 three times. In 1 week, and I mean that's just a tremendous.
That's when she was housed. She did that. She didn't call 911.
Yeah.
She was having a hard time.
Well, okay.
And she wasn't being safe.
Right. She did go at least twice to the hospital. So the steering committee stepped up. I mean, two of us took her around looking for places where she could be, and you know, reach into our own pockets. Found some money to get her in a warm, safe place for a while. So they have that. It's important that I wanted to know that if something arises where one of the people can't be there, we do step in and try to help.
Yes, actually there are no services for people who are in the car. Program one thing. NHS right now is in theory a car camp, but really is a rest stop. So that's the, I know we've had Queen Anne Lions, like now we had some people in the car camp program behind us. And the problem is St. Vincent, well, the resident just doesn't have the person who's in charge of it. Doesn't have the time to provide those kind of services up to the church or someone else to do it. It doesn't happen often enough. So that's why I think the rest stops are much stronger program. I think car camping is good, but people are pretty much on their own unless they can make a connection themselves with the site where they are.
Car camps, they are not as, they're not one program. Basically, car camping is allowed under an ordinance. And so it varies. St. Vincent de Paul operates most of the car camps. The city has an agreement with St. Vincent to operate a lot of the sites. But people can operate them on their own. And then like NHS here, they're not operating under St. Vincent's. So that varies, and St. Vincent's, like Michael said, they don't offer the same level of connection to services that rest stops do.
Right. So people, any idea, do you have any idea?
People, some people stay in them quite long.
Like,
some people do.
Quite long as well.
A couple years. I mean, yeah. Some people do stay in there that long. And then you have people who are operating car camps, businesses that are doing it on their own. The requirements are that you have sanitary facilities, so a bathroom and trash. So if the business does that, then it's kind of up to their agreement with the camper how long they want to allow them to stay.
Thank you. Yeah. Like, well, you know, just thinking, these people are all homeless. Everybody has to have food and clothing and the likes of that.
Electricity.
Well,
water.
You know, but yeah. Like who, how is that provided for these people? I mean, somebody comes with nothing, they have no money, they have no food, they have no clothes. You know, how do y'all assist with that?
We got a common area kitchen where there's a barbecue, where there's a little burner and a barbecue, it's like an oven. So that's where they get, and we get a lot of donations. You'd be amazed how many food donations and clothing donations and blankets.
So it's mostly donations that y'all are using for this.
And what about water and electricity?
Water, right now we're getting some Good Samaritans. And electricity, I have solar panels over there. Yeah, it's a hard